Welcome to our second presentation of the 2020-2021 season, as we continue the process of exploring the digital landscape of music. You have a lot of demands on your time and energy, and we're grateful you've chosen to give your time to Cantata Singers. This broadcast features the next two installments of our Unaccompanied Song Project with works by Elena Ruehr and Peter Child, taking you through the range of emotions, from the serious to the whimsical. Schoenberg's intensely dramatic Psalm 130 rounds out this program. We hope you thoroughly enjoy today's musical journey. Thank you again for sharing your time with Cantata Singers.
Allison, the songs that we are presenting today digitally are the second and third of nine sets of unaccompanied songs. And I thought it was a good moment for us to check in about your thoughts about the process of creating these works and guiding their performances and recording. The originating idea came from you, and so you must have very strong feelings about where we are right now.
The whole process has been extraordinarily uplifting to work with all of these singers, many of whom I have not known. I've known faces, I've known names, but unless they were singing in the chamber series, I really didn't know many of these singers. And I have to tell you, this organization is full of very special people. And to work with them has been an incredible honor. And it's been moving. And to work with you too, David, we worked many years together when I first came to BU. And we've worked together, of course, at Cantata Singers. But just this has been different, to be working exactly together on songs with these individuals, to feel each other's ideas, sometimes disagree, sometimes really agree, but come at it in different ways. It's just been almost a lifeline for me too, an extraordinary joy, and I've looked forward to each coaching with you, and I look forward to more.
As do I, and we look forward to Elena Ruehr songs and Peter Child songs, and then six more sets down the road, and so thank you so much for guiding us all in this, and spending time with me coaching the singers, and talking about the poems and enriching the experience for me and everyone.
To new citizens at a naturalization ceremony, she said, "We are a nation made strong. We are a nation made strong by people like you. By people like you. I'm sometimes asked, when will there be enough women on the Supreme Court? I said, when there are nine, when there are nine, when there are nine, when there are nine, people are shocked, people are shocked, people are shocked, people are shocked. But there'd be nine men, and nobody raised a question about that. If I had any talent in the world, if I had any talent in the world, any talent that God gave me, I would be a great diva. A great diva, a great diva, a great diva. If I had any talent in the world, if I had any talent in the world, any talent that God gave me, I would be a great diva, a great diva, a great diva, diva.
I wondered if you might tell us just a little bit about your own thoughts about Justice Ginsberg.
I have a personal feeling about her, which comes from my mother, who passed this year. And my mother was a huge supporter of great causes. And Ruth Bader Ginsberg was a voice for feminists and for the idea of great justice. And when she passed, I was really sad. And I also thought about my mom. So these pieces are not just about her, but they're also about my mom, who was a great justice seeker.
Elena, as you know, Justice Ginsberg wrote a great deal. And can you just talk a little bit about how you chose the text, how you whittled down quotes and finally arrived at your final four texts?
So some of her quotes are easier to sing than others. Mm-hmm. And it seemed really important to me that we end with the song, A Great Diva, because Ruth Bader Ginsburg was really wanted to be a great diva. She loved opera. Mm-hmm. and it seemed really fitting that this operatic treatment of her words come to life in this song cycle.
I'll probably ask this of all of our commissioned composers, but I'll ask you as well. For centuries, harmony has been such a powerful force in almost all music. And our little project, of course, stole that expressive component from you. And because we were asking you to write songs for solo voices without any accompaniment. So with that expressive possibility gone, how did you approach the problem of creating coherent and expressive solo songs?
How I wrote these songs really has to do a lot with my mother, who was a folk singer. And I thought a lot about how folk singers make melodies and how to make a great melody without accompaniment. And I also thought a lot about, you know, there might be jazz singers or different kinds of singers that would sing without accompaniment. And it's a little simpler. It's a little, you know, you have to be cohesive with your sound material, and you can't be deeply complex chromatically as you might be with a Strauss song or something like that. You have to be a little bit more contained.
It would be nice to hear from each of you how your experience was with singing an unaccompanied song. It's probably not something you do very often. What were the challenges? What were the enjoyable parts of it? Should we start with Epp?
Yes, it was a challenge. And I am so used to learning my music from the harmonic structure behind a piece of music, because I'm a pianist first and a singer second. So I always sort of rely on, like I say, the harmonic structure behind something. So this was something I found it rather difficult, but it worked.
What I so enjoyed about the process was taking text, which I resonated with because I've had the privilege of meeting her. She was a friend of my father's. So wow. I was thrilled that that was the text we got to work with. And of course, I love the particular text I was given. Being also a woman in the law, so that was, I never got to be a judge, but, just finding all the ways to express that. I mean, it's such a short little piece, and yet, as I worked on it, and then I got to work on it with Allison and David, and then finally with Elena, I mean, there were just, it changed so much, and everybody brought something to it, and it was just fascinating to see that interpretive process.
Being from Japan, I didn't have much of a sense of her, know about the history of the women's movement. So I was amazed at what she did to advance women's rights in the US, and it's a great privilege to enjoy those rights. And the song Elena wrote was wonderful, and it was an honor for me to sing it.
I was really grateful to be given that text, which was, we are a people made strong we are a country made nation made strong by people like you. And when I was singing it, I had people in mind that they were in front of me while I was singing, because I work in a big software company and I work with a lot of people who came here from other countries. And I know some of their backstories and how they started their lives in very different circumstances than they are here. And sort of taking on with some of the things that we've talked about, I'm particularly struck by the stories of a couple of women that I work with who came here because they didn't have the opportunities to have an education in the countries they came from. And so the idea that she was saying to the people who are becoming naturalized citizens, that we're a nation made strong by people like you, was very moving to me. And I'm really grateful to have been able to sing that. And then I actually recorded this on January 8th. And I found that the text had an entirely different meaning. On top of that we are a nation made strong by all of us.
Without the powerful element of harmony, how do you go about making an expressive musical entity?
Yeah. But in the end, I was nervous. I was, you know, there was some anxiety associated with that at first. But in the end, what was left for me as kind of composer that I am is line. You know, everything is invested in the line and component features of the line, like motif and contour and climax and anticlimax and things like that. And so I think line became very important, and I'm not, I do feel that these are self-sufficient as unaccompanied lines. That's what I was worried about, that they would never be self-sufficient.
Right.
It's been provisional. I'm not worried about that anymore.
When we've been thinking about this project, I don't think we necessarily imagined that the three or four songs that a composer might write would necessarily create a cycle, especially because each song is going to be sung by a different person.
Yeah.
But I think that's beginning to emerge, that at least numbers of composers are responding to it that way. And it seems that there is a somewhat of a cyclical element in your four songs that really bind them together very, very passionately. And I wondered if you might just tell us a little bit about that before we get to hear the songs.
I love that it's the year of the rat and all of the kind of associations that that phrase has, possible meanings that that has. But the year of the rat begins with a letter in my hair. And then she gave me a poem, which turned out to be the last poem in the cycle, which ends, this year begins with a piece not to be sung twice. And that was a gift.
I haven't yet found a word to describe or pin down the range of possibilities, emotions, and moment during this entire working process. In fact, I don't think an adjective would do it justice, because it was a fairly organic process with its ups and downs. Like all meaningful collaborations, ours was simple and kind. I did encourage a certain level of mystery and flow when we worked and let both of us walk into the unknown. Peter and I communicated with each other in whatever ways we could, given the situation and the fact that we were far from each other. He in Norway, I in France. When a poet and a composer meet, I think of words by the Chinese classical painter Shi Tao. I speak with my hand, you listen with your eyes. I like to leave the rest unsaid, but sung. Thank you.
What your experience has been singing an unaccompanied song, what have been the challenges, what have been the joys?
Yeah, I remember first reading the poem and just finding it almost impenetrable. But then, you know, as I actually work on the music, as the music sort of settles in, and in our coaching sessions, I was happy to discover that, you know, my sort of possibly ambiguous interpretations were not alone. you know, it's in this type of like uncertainty that at least I find myself through a large part of this past 12 months. So I think even the ambiguity sort of has that reflection.
I found that the poetry really got into my brain, such that, you know, there's a line in mine that says at each ripple curve that we talked about how it could depict how we walk during the pandemic, you know, to try to avoid people and having to make all these strange curves in our walking. And every time I'm out walking or running and I'm going near someone and I go out into the street and I come back around, I think about that passage. It's ingrained.
This was difficult. It was hard. It was really hard. Because my whole life has been making music with people. And suddenly I was alone. And I had to reckon with that. I really had to reckon with that. It was, at times it was jubilant, and at other times it was really hard to jump into it and make it happen. And I, in the process of recording the songs, not only was I very critical about what I was doing and my the way I was trying to manage the music, which was so beautiful and yet so difficult in a way of trying to reflect with it, that it took me by surprise. I didn't plan for how it would finally affect me. And I was so grateful that I had a chance to connect with David and Peter and you, Allison, because I have been alone. I've been alone with this camera in front of me.
Oh, Karyl.
I didn't intend to have that happen.
Well, I understand, Karyl, what you're saying, and I relate to it so much. I was dreading having agreed to be a part of this project. I just thought, as time during the pandemic went on, I thought, I just don't have this in me. I don't have the emotional reserves to take this on. And I'm so glad that I pushed through, because I ended up having the opposite experience of what I had feared. I, like you, Karyl, am used to self-judgment, especially in my singing, on such a level as to be just truly self-harming and debilitating. And I really had the opposite experience with this. I was in a place of gratitude to have music to work on, especially a piece with so much detail that really engaged my brain and served to distract from my similar emotionality around it to Karyl. And so, Peter, thank you for giving us, especially mine, such a truly busy page. And I just had to stare at it. And I had to keep staring at it and keep staring at it. And this is what really David, one of my conducting teachers, taught me to do in conducting class, is just keep on staring at that score. Just keep on staring at it. And over time, all of a sudden, you will start to hear it. It will lift off the page and it will come to you.
The year of the rat begins with a letter in my hair. Then the hard bread. Address to hide. None of this present makes more sense than a click. The heart waits for a swing to feel alive, to feel alive.
This is how Paris finds out its cars can't move, can't move, can't move. Windows scream for attention. Nothing happens. Nothing happens. Nothing but each cathedral hardens its breath.
Then the stone in a jar, not to be touched, not to be touched, not to be touched, but must be healed. Putting on, putting on, putting on its best behavior at each ripple curve, then the stone in a jar, not to be touched, not to be touched.
Away to rationalize names.